Welcome to Jacob's Well Church this morning. We're happy to see all of you. Welcome to everyone who is new this morning. I've met some of you. Welcome to everyone who is not new. It's good to see all of us together. I just wanted to read here from Psalm 18. I'll share a very small story from my last week here. Well, this past week anyway. So Psalm 18, I'm just going to go from verse 6 and then verses 16 through 19. So Psalm 18, verse 6, it says, "In my distress, I called upon the Lord. To my God, I cried for help. From his temple, he heard my voice, and my cry to him reached his ears." And now verse 16, "He reached down from on high and took me, and he drew me out of the mighty waters. He delivered me from my strong enemy and from those who hated me, for they were too mighty for me. They confronted me in the day of my calamity, but the Lord was my support. He brought me out into the broad place. He delivered me because he delighted in me." Danielle and I went to a wedding this last week with all of our other Christmas celebrations. We drove over to Tacoma on Thursday and then came back yesterday. And while we were there for the wedding, we went out, because Tacoma's right on the water. We went hiking in a place called Defiance Point. There we go. Defiance Point, so I had a bunch of cool hiking spots, and you can go out on the water. And so we were walking along, just along the sound there, and we could see, there's seals swimming in the water, and there's the Cascade Mountains in the background, and they're just very beautiful. They have, gigantic islands in the middle of the sound there. And as we're walking along, we're like, wow, look at those mountains, those are great. And I'm like, wow, look at the seals and these trees, and it was just amazing. And then after about three quarters of a mile, I turned around, and there's Mount Rainier. Just like right there. I couldn't see the thing until I turned around. Right, we were walking around and just looking at all these great mountains in the distance and all everything that was around us. And then it was not until I changed my perspective that I saw this enormous mountain right in front of us. Well, actually right behind us. That is what it was. I was thinking about that. Maybe me, I don't know about you. But many times I can get distracted either with good or negative things that are just in front of me. Right? Maybe they look like mountains, maybe they're big trees. Some of these trees are 30, 40, 50 feet tall. How big are the Cascade Mountains? They're also pretty big. But they're nothing in comparison to Mount Rainier. It is just enormous once I turned around. So thinking about that, whether it's good, whether it's bad, we have all kinds of stuff that's going along. And I was thinking about, I kind of reflected on that, and then reading that place from David, is that God doesn't change. I change, right? Mount Rainier didn't change. It was still the same height as it was when I was under the trees, but now my perspective, when I moved, when I got out from those things, I was able to see the mountain for what it was. Where I can get focused on the things around me, like I said, whether good or bad. The mountains are beautiful, the mountains are lovely, the water is great and lovely, but focusing on that, if I only looked at that, I would have missed the majestic Mount Rainier. Mount Rainier was still the same mountain, right? It didn't change at all. It's just my perspective on the mountain changed when I was able to get out from where I was. So I'd encourage us this morning, whatever mountains or trees or things we have around us, let's try to shift our focus and maybe change our perspective so we can view God for who God really is. Right? God doesn't change. God's always there. And we need to remember the mightiness of God. Can we try to do that this morning? Whatever things are around us, whatever surrounding us, let's remember who God is and how God created. And like David talked about, his situation was not a great one, but God came down and did something great in him and for him. Amen?
Amen.
God can do and still does those same things for us. So let me pray as we begin. Heavenly Father, I thank you that we could come together this morning. Lord, I ask that you would just work in all of us, Lord. Help to move us around and change us and change our perspective to be able to see you for who you are. Help us not to get bogged down or distracted, even by lovely things or by the challenges or hardships that we face. But help us to remember that you are there, even greater than the mountains, Lord. You are always there. Help us to change our perspective and to be able to see you and know you for who you really are. Pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Let's go ahead and stand and worship the Lord in this wonderful Christmas and now Epiphany time. Because in the darkness we were waiting without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the word from a throne of endless glory to a cradle. Jesus' name. Jesus, the only one who can ever
Pour your spirit out. Jesus in John 12, it says in verse 1 through 8, 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, where Lazarus lived. Remember, Jesus had just raised Lazarus from the grave. He had a dinner, and they threw a dinner in Jesus' honor. And Martha served while Lazarus was reclining at the table with Jesus. Quite a dinner. after death, being resurrected and having a meal with the one who resurrected you. It's a bizarre scenario. It's one we all look forward to, though, that Jesus will sit at a table with each one of us and those we love who are in Christ and are resurrected, that we will eat together again. A beautiful picture of heaven on earth at that table.
Yeah.
So that's a beautiful picture there. But at that table, something happened. And this is what I want to leave you with today. Mary took about a pint of pure nard, an expensive perfume, and she poured it on Jesus' feet and wiped his feet with her hair, and the house filled with the fragrance of the perfume. One of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, who was later to betray Jesus, objected to the whole thing. Why wasn't this perfume sold and the money given to the poor? It's worth a year's wages. He did not say this because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. And as a keeper of their money bag, he used to help himself to what was put into it. Leave her alone, Jesus replied. It was intended that she should save this perfume for the day of my burial. And you will always have the poor among you, but you will not always have me. As I was reflecting on this passage this last week, in light of knowing what was happening and what was going to be today and our time of world missions and the whole subject matter, I found myself thinking about that line where Jesus says, this perfume, this expensive gift was intended. There was an intention for this gift, that God, in his miraculous plans and wild ways, had held this perfume in Mary's life, that she had made many decisions with that perfume, but for whatever reason, she never opened it, used it, sold it, kept it, and that in her keeping of this great resource, this great expensive amount of money, that there was an intended use for that perfume. An intended use for it. It was to pour that expensive perfume on the feet of Jesus. That there was going to come a moment where she was going to know what this resource and this need, that they were supposed to come together.
Right.
And how each of us, in some form or fashion, have an expensive perfume, a resource, whether it be ourselves or money or gifts and talents, our time, whatever, that many times we are holding on to. And God is going to provide a place and a moment for us to pour out that gift that we have been holding onto the work and person of Jesus. It is an amazing thing to have been a part of our journey as a church to pour on the feet of the refugees that we have met over the years. Not only Karen, not only Kareni, not only Iraqi and Afghani and many others. It has been an honor that we as a church have been able to take our resources and fill the room with the perfume of Christians serving Jesus with their resources.
Yeah.
Caring for the poor. Helping people get housing. Helping people get jobs. Helping people with medical appointments. Helping people learn English. All kinds of various small and big ways that we've had the honor to pour on the feet of Jesus, as it were, our love and devotion and our resources. That's what missions is about. Missions is about that a love comes into your heart and you start looking at a way to show that love. And most often it means somebody needs something and you're going to be a provider of that. It may be love and support of people going through programs and rebuilding their lives and fleeing violence of their own homes and trying to provide a safe life for their children. It might be coming along those who are suffering and struggling to be sober one more day. It might be many different things that we see each day. But you know who's going to fill the house with perfume? It's not going to be God just in his own sense out there. He's going to work through people to release resources and care and love and attention. And even to some degree, sometimes risk their own lives to go to places to be alongside people who are suffering, that the fragrance of God's love and service and action might fill the room.
Yes.
And there's always a critique. You can't do anything in the kingdom of God without somebody complaining about the way it was done, how it was done, should it have been done. That will never cease. And too many people don't go forward and do something because they're afraid of someone complaining about how it's been done. We have not been perfect. For 17 years as a church, we have tried to serve, to love, to care, to have open hearts, to give resources far beyond the size of our congregation. Not only to give resources, but to send our best, to send those we love for 10 years in South Sudan and Uganda from our own congregation. We have supported and prayed and walked alongside stories that we don't even know the people that are living that until 2023. One of them stands here behind the pulpit to say, your prayers have been a part of these stories. But at the heart of it, it's the love of Christ that motivates. And I felt compelled, like there was perfume being held. I'm not asking for your perfume, but I'm asking you to ask Jesus where to spill it. Where will you pour out what God has given you for his intended purposes? What and where is the smell of death that you could bring something beautiful to? Jesus said, hey, I'm being prepared to die. And she brought something to my death. It's a beautiful thing to me to think of that woman washing Jesus' feet with the perfume, her hair. And I was reminded at last of Isaiah's passage. In 52:7, there's a verse here. How beautiful on the mountains, I thought of even the places you've been. How beautiful on the mountains are the feet. Not the intentions, not just the good thoughts, but the people who have put their feet where they need to be. How beautiful on the mountains are the feet of those who bring good news, who proclaim peace, who bring good tidings, and who proclaim salvation, and who say to Zion, your God reigns. Beautiful feet right there. Beautiful feet right there. Beautiful feet in every one of these places in this room. You are people engaged in good work. And when you see Jesus, I know he will say, yeah, beautiful, beautiful stories that have been told because you were willing to put your feet in difficult places. And that's been at the heart of our church. And as we go into 2024 and we look at where God is calling us to work and serve and invest and grow, we want to be a church that has the heart of Jesus at it. We want to have a Mary's heart that maybe in my resources, in my savings, in my gifts, talents, and time, there's perfume intended for God's good work in 2024. And what we will see happen in this new year that's meaningful will come from the place of love and devotion and sacrifice to Jesus. And may that fragrance not only touch our church, but may it spill out into this neighborhood, spill out through all the good works everyone's involved in doing in this town, and spread out to the very trenches of people hiding under bamboo, hoping they don't get bombed. Father, I pray in Jesus' name that as we come to the close of one year and we thankfully are able to look forward to a new one, that Lord, we make a commitment in our hearts to be your hands and your feet and your heart, that we may support the good works that you're doing in all these different storylines we're connected to. May you use us, Lord, through prayer and through sending and through supporting, Lord, the good things you're doing. May we, Father, look upon our lives with faith in 2024 and see what has God called us to next? What is God calling us to be faithful to and remain faithful to? What is God calling me to do? And what is God called? How has God called me to use my resources to be poured out on the feet of Jesus in the hardest places, in the least reached places, in the mountains, God? And may all of us come to the close of 2024 with anointed feet and feet of peace, declaring that our God has reigned in 2024, I pray. If you're in that place of your life right now, you feel you're in danger, you feel like you're in a great battle, you're in a great struggle, I'm here to tell you that God loves you and He is sending people to love and support you in your battles. You are not alone. And I pray that you will yield your heart and life to Him this year, and that He will show you His plans and purposes for you through whatever hell you've been through, whatever hardship you may face, that God will be faithful to you if you give Him your heart and life. And I pray that you'd be blessed as Leela's son, that the blessing of the Lord would be over you, over all the elements of your life, in the way that would glorify Jesus and advance His kingdom in 2024, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen.